God has called you to be different. He's called you to have a different lifestyle and not simply be just like the culture who's trying to live for the human trinity, me, myself, and I, instead of the spiritual one, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. As a former NFL football player and a collegiate athlete, I always identified myself with football, but now I don't play it anymore. So what happens when you lose the thing you identify with? You realize that that should have never been your identity. When you understand that your identity is in Christ, now you understand that no matter what you do, you can truly be who you are, because that's something that will never change, even when life circumstances do change. We're not called to follow our heart. We're called to demand that our heart follows the truth. It's time to build on this right foundation, and it's time to do it right now, because there's no time to wait.
A sower went out to sow his seed, and as he sowed, some fell along the path and was trampled underfoot, and the birds of the air devoured it. And some fell on the rock, and as it grew up, it withered away because it had no moisture. And some fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up with it and choked it. And some fell into good soil and grew and yielded 100-fold. The seed is the word of God. The ones along the path are those who have heard. Then the devil comes and takes away the word from their hearts, so that they may not believe and be saved. And the ones on the rock are those who, when they hear the word, receive it with joy. But these have no root. They believe for a while, and in time of testing, fall away. And as for what fell among the thorns, they are those who hear. But as they go on their way, they are choked by the cares and riches and pleasures of life, and their fruit does not mature. As for that in the good soil, they are those who, hearing the word, hold it fast in an honest and good heart, and bear fruit with patience. He who has ears to hear, let him hear.
Welcome back to Different. We're exploring the parables of Jesus in order to see how great it is to be different in our world today. In the last session, we learned that all of us need Jesus. If we continue to make a habit out of comparing our lives to other people, we'll begin to think that their sin is worse or somehow we're better. The story of the two debtors reminds us that we all owe a debt, and what makes us different is that we've been forgiven. Right now, we're going to talk about the condition of our hearts as Jonathan walks us through the parable of the sower. Many situations in life can leave our hearts wounded and hardened, leaving us little desire for vulnerability. But we want to have a heart that's open to receiving God's word. Ariana struggled to let God's word penetrate her heart. Let's listen to her story.
My mom and dad always drove me into church and never really learned a lot. I think I didn't get anything from it because nobody gave me like deeper context. It didn't really make sense to me. Adam and Eve, and I was like, who are these people? I was so confused. I guess somebody just had to like actually break down the Bible with me in order for me to understand it. Me and my friends, we were going to a party. I didn't know that they were gonna be smoking and drinking. When I got there, they were like, just take a puff, it's not gonna hurt you, you'll be fine. And I was like, nah, I'm okay, I'm fine. She was like, if you don't smoke, if you don't do this, then you're not in our crew. When she told that to me, I was just like, well, I guess I got to do it because these are my real friends and they wouldn't do anything to hurt me. I kind of knew that I shouldn't be doing this. So I was just disappointed in myself when I did it because I didn't think nobody could influence me. I had this youth pastor that really helped me a lot. He helped me walk through the Bible and he helped me dig deeper and break it down more to where I can understand it. The scripture they used was watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. Peer pressure, I guess, went into that because I know I shouldn't be doing it, but my flesh was weak, so it made me fall into that peer pressure. My walk with Christ, it made me realize, like, the friends that I had, they weren't going down the same path that I was going. My truths and theirs wasn't the same, and so I guess it just caused us to grow apart from each other. I knew that I needed to hang around the people that were going to help me grow in Christ, and God was putting me in a different position.
I want to thank Ariana for that awesome testimony. Listen, being transparent leads to transformation. And that's what she was able to do. She talked about how she struggled in crossing the line as it relates to her friends and peer pressure and what they were trying to get her to do. And she stepped over that boundary, but it led her to be cautious and conscious about the fact that she really needs to go deeper in God's word so that she doesn't continue to cross over these boundaries. And a lot of us have to think the same way. We're always going to be in a situation where we get tempted. When I was in high school and when I was in college, listen, every level, it just keeps leveling up. When it relates to the culture's pressure and the culture's temptation, that's what you all experience. And that's what I experienced in my life as well. That's why I want to talk about this parable that Jesus talks about, this seed, because it's the seed principle found in Luke chapter 8, verses 4 through 15. He wants to make sure that you know that the sower is perfect, that the seed is perfect, but it has to find the right soil in order to fully express itself and germinate and have the life that that seed was always meant to have. It's all about the soil. Jesus is the perfect teacher. He's the sower in the parable. Then you have the seed. The seed is the word of God. Well, that's perfect as well. What about the soil? Well, the soil is imperfect. So if the soil isn't right, even though you have a perfect teacher with a perfect word, you still will not get the full expression of what that seed is able to do. And he said that sower went out and sowed seeds. And some seeds fell on the roadside. In other words, they fell on concrete and they were trampled underfoot and birds of the air came and swooped down and ate them up. Other seed fell in rocky soil. And so they had a little bit of good soil, but there was too many rocks in there for the seed to get down deep in order for it to catch root and fully express itself. Some of us have a soil of rock. We have a soil of concrete. We have the roadside soil, as Jesus was saying in this parable. And that means that your heart is not interested in learning the word of God. When you come to church a lot like I did when I was growing up. Man, I came to church because my dad is a pastor. My mom wanted to support him, and she always woke us up, but I wasn't interested in listening to him at home. I sure wasn't interested in listening to him behind a pulpit. I was sleeping. I wasn't taking notes. I wasn't interested. And that led me to a lot of problems because the seed was not implanted in my heart. And that seed is able to save you in situations like Ariana talked about. And when you talk about those situations in your life, if you come to church or your youth group the same way that I came to church when I was a kid, then you will have the same experiences I had. When I fell in temptation, it's because I didn't have the word of God living in me, even though I heard it all the time. You can hear God's word, but that doesn't mean you heard God's word. There is a different heart and a different aspect to this that God is calling us to, and you don't have to wait until you're older to get there. I used to think that all the time. Oh, when I'm older, I'll change my heart. I'll change the scenario. I'll be the person that serves in church. I'll do what my parents are doing when I get there. No, the time is now. And when you experience this seed getting implanted, which is able to save you in those situations that Ariana talked about, you want to start changing that soil because it has the ability to keep you from crossing boundaries that can really hurt you and not just your present, but also your future. I remember when I was in the NFL, my coach would always say, hey, you need to hold that ball high and tight because the enemy is always coming to strip it. The defense in the NFL, man, they're treacherous and they're coming fast and they're coming hard to strip that ball away from you. Listen, you want to hold God's word close to your heart. You don't want to have a heart of concrete. You want to hold it high and tight because the devil, if it's just sitting on top of the roadside, the devil is coming like those birds in the air and he's coming to strip that ball from you so that you have a lot of fumbles in your life. Fumbles in life are real setbacks. But then he also says there were some who had rocky soil. In other words, they had a little bit of good soil, but they had rocks in there with it. Some of us are double-minded, like the Bible says in James chapter 1, verse 7. Double-minded in all our ways. In other words, we have a little bit of good soil, a little bit of good heart. We're kind of here to hear the word, but we also have cultural stones that are in the way. We want to hear what God says, but we want to hear what our friends say. We want to hear what God says, but we want to look at our social media feed to see what it says. And when you have those two worlds colliding, you have a great seed, you have a great sower, but it cannot fully express itself because there's too many things in the way. The question is, which soil are you? We need to open our heart to have a different heart so that seed can fully express itself, so you can fully express yourself.
So I was really close to my grandpa. He'd come to my football games, he'd come to my basketball games, he'd come to as many sporting events as he could. He was just kind of always there and always a protector and always a comforter for me. He was a really good example of what a Christ follower was, a really generous guy. So my grandpa got sick. He had Lewy body dementia, and then he just kind of like started getting really worse over like a 3-month period. One night, I was hanging out with friends actually, and my dad called me and said, hey, Papa's getting worse. We need you to come back. And then he passed away, and that was really hard. I just couldn't process it because it led me into a season of just confusion and anger. I didn't know why God would do this. I didn't want anything to do with him because he did this. I just kind of doubted God and doubted his goodness. Like, I knew he was there. I knew he was in charge of my life. I just didn't think he had my best interest at heart. I just didn't think that any good could come out of this situation. And I kind of like isolated myself in my spiritual walk. I have a group of guys, which is my small group, that I have accountability with, that we do Bible studies with. And I just kind of separated myself from that. I just wasn't authentic and didn't really share what was going on. I just kind of backed away and just kind of separated myself. So I heard an opportunity at our church about going to a camp for kids with special needs. So serving at Camp Barnabas with those kids really impacted my spiritual life for the better. The love of Christ just really flowed through those kids. They showed me that even in the hardest circumstances, you can have happiness. God used a specific camper named Matthew. He was my camper that I was partnered up with for the week. Seeing him just really inspired me that it doesn't matter what your situation is, you can always be happy because God loves you. God is good through those tough times. And it really inspired me to live like that and live happy and not look at people's outward appearances, but look at the heart and just love them for who they are.
I want to thank Noah for that testimony. It's always hard when you have something like that happen in your life. He lost his grandfather. They had a close relationship. And many of you may have lost someone. If you haven't lost someone, you have different external things that are happening in your life. Maybe it's someone who's supposed to be there that's not there. Maybe it's someone that you trusted who did something or harmed you in a way that really affected you and hurt you. Either way, no matter what you have gone through, I'm sure it's something because we live in this world. It's hurtful things that happen that seek to choke out God's word, that seek to make us want to question him and doubt him and lose faith. And how could a good God allow these things to happen to me? And that's why I want to go over Luke chapter 8. And we're talking about this seed, talking about the sower who sowed these seeds. The seed is important because it's living, not just for good times, but even when you experience bad times, so that you can figure out how to come out of it like Noah did. He went to camp and he continued to get the word, he continued to serve others, and he realized that there was a purpose in his pain. If you only think about the pain or the bad things that have happened in your life, trust me, the seed of God's word will get choked out by the worries of this world, by the anxiety, by the depression that we experience. That seed will get choked out. But if you position yourself, have a different heart, and be open to trusting the creator of all things, that he knows why it happened to you, and he knows exactly how he wants to use it. He's saying he's throwing these seeds out there. The word of God is being tossed out there. Some of those seeds are on the roadside. Some of those seeds are in rocky soil. Some of those seeds get caught in the thorns. And that's what Noah was talking about. Noah was talking about a thorn in his life when he lost his grandfather. Many of us have those thorns. And those thorns in our life, those prickly things that hurt us when they touch us or when they come to us, are the things that seek to choke out the word of God so that we doubt him, we lose faith in him, we don't want to come to church, we don't even want to be around our church friends, we don't want to be around anything that has anything to do with God because of the pain that I'm in. But do you want your pain to be used, or do you want your pain to continue to abuse you? Because that's all that will happen if you don't give your life to God, who knows the reason for your pain, and he knows exactly how he wants to use it. Understand that pain is important in order for you to actually have a purpose that's going to be meaningful to other people. God wants you to be able to give. And if you don't have a testimony, if you don't have anything to show for your life, then how can you help somebody else the next time they're struggling? God allows those things so that he can position you for his purposes in the ministry that he's calling you to. And don't get scared. When I say ministry, I'm not just talking about the church. No matter what you do, you're supposed to be in ministry, because you're always supposed to be living to promote the gospel of Jesus Christ. But the gospel of Jesus Christ has pain. Even Jesus Christ had thorns on his head that created pain, but it was for you to experience your salvation. That's what your pain is for. So don't allow the soil of your heart to stay thorny. Don't allow the soil of your heart to continue to choke the seed out because of the things you're going through. It's time to open up our heart to receive the word of God so that it can get planted real deep, so that it can take root, germinate, and fully express ourselves in our life, so that we can experience the life that God has always called us to have. Listen, you never will go and see a superhero movie. I'm a superhero guy. I love superhero movies. I love all of them. The Avengers, Superman, Bat, it doesn't matter who it is. I love it because I can't do what they do, and I wish I could. So I'm sitting in the seat. You will never see a superhero movie where there is no evil or nothing bad happening. What kind of dumb movie would that be if the superhero, Captain Marvel, is just flying around in space, but there's no problem that she needs to solve? If there's no problem, there's no reason for a superhero. And God wants you to understand that he allows problems in our life, even like Noah talked about, or even like you experienced. He allows those problems so that you don't just think of him as super, but he actually becomes your hero. He actually becomes the one that you lean to and that you go to, because you know that in his word is all the ingredients necessary to serve up something that tastes really good for where God is calling you. And that's why he allows it. So don't let those thorns choke out that seed. Open your heart to have good soil so that you can experience the hero named Jesus Christ, who's sowing seed called his very own word. When you experience that, you get to experience what it's like to live under the rule of God with this one life that you're given. My dad always told me, life is like a dollar bill. You get to have it, but you're only going to get to spend it once. So you better spend it well. And that can only happen with a different heart.
Noah struggled to trust God after the death of his grandfather. His heart became hardened toward God like the seed that fell by the roadside. Jonathan told us that there are different types of soils that we can all relate to in different seasons of our lives. Hopefully, we can learn to live a life allowing Christ to penetrate the wounds of our hearts. So, which soil are you? Are you simply a fan of Jesus, or has he actually changed you from the inside out? Discuss with your group a few steps you can take toward maturing in Christ this week. We'll see you next time.